गुड मॉर्निंग स्टूडेंट्स, वेलकम टू द रियल एनालिसिस लाइव लेक्चर्स। सो इन प्रीवियस लेक्चर्स वी हैव सीन व्हाट इज मीन बाय टोटली बाउंडेड सेट। अ सेट इज सेड टू बी टोटली बाउंडेड इफ इट कैन बी कवर्ड बाय एप्सिलॉन और ओपन बॉल्स, राइट। इट कैन बी कवर्ड बाय देयर एग्जिस्ट एप्सिलॉन ग्रेटर देन जीरो सच दैट। व्हाट इज टोटली बाउंडेड सेट? Can anybody recall?
If A is
containing union of open balls, right, of radius epsilon. Okay, I hope you have gone through it. And another definition also we can state as if a set can be covered with opens or sets with diameter less than epsilon also, okay, that is also totally bounded, and we have seen some theorems also on it. Now in today's lecture we are going to see what is complete metric space. I hope you can able to read this complete metric space, whatever is there on the screen. Can you see this?
Yes ma'am.
Okay. So,
yes, ma'am.
What is complete metric space? Let us first define it. Let M D be a metric space, and it is said to be complete if every Cauchy sequence in M, if converges in M, and we already know that R is complete metric space. We have already proved that. Okay. In first unit, we have already proved this. Every Cauchy sequence of real numbers converges in R, right?
Yes,
now
yes,
we have to we can also say state that every discrete metric space is complete. Again, if we want to show some metric space is complete, we have to start with a Cauchy sequence. Okay, so start with a Cauchy sequence. So let Xn be a Cauchy sequence in discrete metric space and show that it converges in that space. Okay, so when we say a sequence converges,
the distance between x2 is less than epsilon.
For every epsilon greater than zero, there exists a natural number such that sequence, since it is a Cauchy sequence, for every epsilon there exists natural number, right? So in particular, for epsilon is equal to half, also there exists natural number such that distance of xn xm is less than half, right, for all n m greater equal to k. Now what this implies, for every epsilon it implies means distance of xn xm must be 0 for all n m greater than equal to k. So this implies xn is equal to xm for all n and m greater than equal to k, right? So what this implies, xn minus xk is equal to 0, or we can say it is less than epsilon for all n greater than equal to k. Is it right? So this implies xn converges to xk, and xk is an element of that space only. Therefore, that metric space is a complete metric space. Is that okay?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes. If we take open interval 0, 1. It is not complete because if we have already proved this, 1 by n is a Cauchy sequence in 0, 1, but it does not converges in 0, 1. What is the limit of 1 by n, this sequence?
0.
It is 0, but that 0 does not belong to this space. Therefore, it is not complete metric space. Whereas, if I take close interval 0, 1, then it is complete metric space, okay? Because every Cauchy sequence will converge in this closed interval 0, 1. Therefore, this closed interval 0, 1 is complete metric space. Now, next theorem. Let MD be a complete metric space and AD be a subset of metric space. Okay, let's draw it. Suppose this is your metric space MD and A is a subset of this M. This is A. Then AD is complete if and only if this AD is complete if and only if A is closed. So when we say that a subset is closed, when we say that a subset is closed, if it contains all its limit points, right? If it contains all its limit points. So start with a sequence which with a convergence sequence and show that its limit point belongs to that set. Okay. So So whichever set we want to show close, start with it. So let AD be a complete subset of a MD, metric space MD, and start with a sequence in A. Like this, okay. Xn converges to X in M. Now, Xn converges in M. And it is Cauchy also. Why it is? It is, we have started. Let's see, let's start with here. We are taking sequence from subset A. Okay, so if Xn is a sequence in A, it is a sequence in M also. Can you see this? Yes, we have started with a sequence Xn converges to X. Okay, and now we want to show this X belongs to this A, then we can say that A is closed set. So since Xn is a sequence in A, then it will be a sequence in MD also, but M is complete and every convergent sequence is Cauchy, right? Every convergent sequence is Cauchy. So what we know? Every Cauchy sequence in complete metric space converges in that space itself. Therefore, X must belongs to A. Are you getting this? Since AD is complete, Xn is Cauchy, it will converge in A. So, A contains all its limit points. A contains all its limit point. Therefore, A is closed. Is that okay? Students, can you hear me?
Yes.
Yes. Yes, ma'am. Okay, now what is the other way? This is if and only if statement. Now suppose A is closed and show that it is complete. Okay. So to show complete, again we require to start with a Cauchy sequence. So let Xn be a Cauchy sequence in A. Then it will be Cauchy sequence in M also. And since M is complete, Xn will converge to some X. Since A is closed,
yes.
X will belongs to A because A contains all its limit points. All its limit points. Since it is closed, right? Therefore, AD is complete. Is that okay?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes.
Yes, ma'am.
Again,
yes,
another examples are close interval 0 to infinity, then set of natural numbers, set of integers, all are complete metric spaces. Okay, now we have to see the next theorem. We have to prove three statements are equivalent. So let MD be a metric space, then the following statements are equivalent. These are again important theorem. So what is first statement? M is complete. Then second is, if F1 is containing F2 containing F3, be decreasing sequence of non-empty closed sets. Okay, so if we are having a decreasing sequence of non-empty closed sets in M with diameter of Fn converges to 0, then intersection of that closed sets is non-empty and it contains exactly one point. Okay, it is like nested interval theorem, right? Can you recall that theorem for intervals? I1 containing, I2 containing In, right? And how are my ins? Closed and bounded intervals. So similar over here, but here my sets are closed sets in metric space. M is first statement was M is complete. Second one was decreasing sequence of closed sets whose diameter tending to zero. Then intersection Fn is non-empty. Intersection is non-empty and it contains exactly one point. And what is third statement? Every infinite totally bounded subset of M has a limit point in M. Every infinite totally bounded subset of M has a limit point in M. Okay, so one we have to prove these three statements equivalent. So one by one we will prove. 1 implies 2. So what is my M? 1, M is, suppose M is complete. Okay, and start with a decreasing sequence F1 containing F2 containing F3, which is a decreasing sequence of closed sets in M, such that diameter of that Fn tends to 0. Now each Fn is non-empty. Okay, now since each Fn is non-empty, start with element Xn in Fn. Okay, so what can I say about this set? Xk, k greater equal to n. It will contain in Fn for all n. If I take set Xk such that k greater equal to n, it will be contained in Fn. Okay, let's draw what is F1, F2. F3, Fn. Let's draw with this. What is my F1? F1 is bigger one. Decreasing sets, na? F1. So this is F2. This is F3. And so on. Okay? So this is F1, F2, F3, and so on. Okay? And how are that sets? Diameter of each Fn is tending to 0. Okay, now I am taking Xn is in Fn. So if X1 belongs to F1, X2 belongs to F2, X3 belongs to F3. So what can I say about F3? X3
belongs to F1.
It will belong to F1 also, F2 also, and F3 also, right?
Yeah.
If I take element from this. So I can say this xk, k greater equal to n. Xk, set of all xk's, k greater equal to n, it will contain in Fn for all n. Can you agree on this?
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes, ma'am.
Because of this decreasing sequence. Okay. Now, what is diameter of this set now? Diameter of xk, k greater equal to n, diameter of this set must be less than equal to Fn. Because it contains in Fn, but diameter of each Fn tends to 0 as n tends to infinity. Therefore, diameter of this set also tending to 0 as n tends to infinity. So, what can I say about this set? This Xn is a Cauchy, right? Distance between elements in this set is tending to 0 means this sequence is a Cauchy sequence, right? Yeah. And what is given? M is complete. So what I get? Xn is Cauchy, M is complete. So Xn must converge to X in M.
Yes, ma'am.
Now, again, what is extra? Each Fn is closed. So it X must contain in Fn, right? Because Fn contains
yes,
all its limit points. So X must belongs to Fn for every n. Therefore, what can I say about intersection of Fn? It must be non-empty, right? Now, what we want to show? It contains exactly one point. Intersection is non-empty, we have already shown. Now we want to show it contains exactly one point. So to show this, start with two. Suppose it contains two elements. Let X and Y belongs to intersection of Fn. But what is distance between X and Y? It must be less than or equal to diameter of Fn. Right?
Yes.
And which tends to zero. Therefore, distance of xy must be 0. Therefore, x must be equal to y. Is that okay? So, if m is complete and if there is a decreasing sequence of closed sets with the diameter of each fn tends to 0, then intersection of all fn's must be non-empty and it contains exactly one point. Okay, now we will prove 2 implies 3. What is 2? If it is a decreasing sequence of closed sets, then its intersection is non-empty and contains exactly one point. Okay, that we have assumed, and we have to show infinite totally bounded subset in M. What is my third one? Let me show this. Bolzano-Weierstrass theorem. Actually, it is has a limit point in M. Okay. Every infinite totally bounded subset of M has a limit point in M. So start with infinite totally bounded subset of M and show that it has a limit point in M. So let A be an infinite totally bounded subset of M. Okay, so let this is your metric space. A is a totally bounded subset. This is your A, totally bounded subset of M. Now, since it is infinite and totally bounded, it contains a Cauchy sequence of distinct points. I can have a Cauchy sequence of distinct points. In totally bounded sets, we have already proved a theorem. Okay, from that, we can have a Cauchy sequence. So let denote this set by n. Let n is equal to xk, k greater equal to n. So what can I say about that a1, a2, a3? A1 must containing A2, containing A3 and so on. Again, it will be a decreasing sequence.
Yes, ma'am.
Yes.
Yes, ma'am.
So, if we can have here only, we can write. So if I write this. Okay, A1, A2, A3 and so on. Okay. Now, what is given? If A1, A2, A3, this is a decreasing sequence, we have got a decreasing sequence and Xn is a Cauchy. So, what can I say about diameter of An? It tends to 0 as n tends to infinity. Now, if I
Okay.
want to apply two, I need closed sets. So how can I have closed sets? Take closures of that sets. I am having sequence A1 containing A2 containing A3 and so on. I want closed sets, so I can take its closures. Closures also will satisfy that same thing. Okay, so it implies. So, but what is diameter of an closure also? It is nothing but diameter of an. Right, diameter of an closure is nothing but diameter of an, and which convert which tends to zero.
Yes, ma'am. Right.
Yeah. So what can I say? Its intersection must be non-empty. Intersection of n closures must be non-empty. N is equal to 1 to infinity. By second, that is our assumption, right?
Yes,
so let start with that point. Let x belongs to that intersection. So x belongs to every n closure. Now since xn is containing n and n containing n closure, we get xn belongs to n closure. So what is distance between xn and x? It must be less than or equal to diameter of n closure. Xn belongs to n closure, x belongs to n closure. Is it right? Xn belongs to n closure, x belongs to n closure. So what and distance between xn and x I want. It must be less than or equal to diameter of n closure. So it must tends to 0. Therefore, xn must converges to x. So what this means? X is a limit point of A. Okay. So every infinite totally bounded subset of M has a limit point. Now we want to prove 3 implies 1. Okay. So what is our assumption now? Every totally bounded infinite totally bounded subset has a limit point, and we want to prove M is complete. Metric space is complete. So if I want to show some space is complete, how we will start? Start with the Cauchy sequence. Okay. Start with arbitrary Cauchy sequence. So let xn be a Cauchy sequence and let denote xn, this set A is equal to xn and n equal to 1. Then A is totally bounded. Already proved this theorem in totally bounded section. We already proved this theorem. Can you recall this? Yes. So if A is finite, then there are infinitely many xk's which are equal, and hence we get a subsequence which converges. Is it right? There will be two cases, right? If A is finite, if A is infinite. If it is finite. If it is finite means there must be infinitely many xk which are same. Right? What is my A? A is nothing but x1, x2, x3 and so on. If it is finite, we are saying finite means some it will be like terms of that sequence are repeated for infinitely many xk's, right, which are equal. Therefore we get a subsequence which converges. Are you getting this? And now suppose if A is infinite, then by theorem 2, A has a limit point. If it is infinite, infinite and totally bounded means it must have a limit point which belongs to M. Therefore, for every epsilon, for this epsilon is equal to 1 by k, we can have xn k belongs to this ball of radius 1 by k and a minus x. So xn k belongs to this ball of radius 1 by k and center x. But where are xn k? Xn k is in a. So what can I say? Distance of xn k and x must be less than 1 by k, means it tends to 0 as k tends to infinity. Therefore xn k must converges to x. This subsequence converges to x, and which is limit point. Okay, therefore what can I say? Xn k is a convergent subsequence of xn. So what can I say about this sequence? Xn is Cauchy and xn converges to x, therefore m must be complete. Is it okay? If every convergent subsequence of xn converges to x, means that sequence, original sequence, must converges to x. And that sequence is Cauchy also. Right? Therefore, m must be complete. So, this proves 1 implies 2, 2 implies 3, and 3 implies 1. Is that okay? Is it okay? So what is contraction map? A map F from M to M is said to be contraction if there exists alpha which lies between 0 to 1, less than, strictly less than 1. Huh? It can be 0, but it must be strictly less than 1, such that distance between fx, fy is less than or equal to alpha times distance between xy for every xy in M. Then we say that map is a contraction map. Okay. Now what is the example? For example, fx is equal to x by 2. If you take x belongs to R, then f is a contraction because mod of fx minus fy will be mod of x by 2 minus y by 2, and you can take half outside, then half times mod of xy. So your alpha is nothing but half here, which belongs to close 0, open 1, right? Therefore this f is a contraction map on R. What about f of x is equal to x? Identity map. What is mod of fx minus f of y? It is mod of x minus y. So what is your alpha? Alpha is equal to 1. It does not belongs to close open 0 1. I want that alpha strictly less than 1, right? Are you getting this? Therefore, yes, this map is not contraction map. So, identity map is not a contraction map. Is that okay?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. So, now next definition, fixed point. So, what is mean by fixed point? Which cannot be changed, right? Fixed means fixed, not changed. So, a point x0 in M is called a fixed point of a map F from M to M. F from matrix space to matrix space MD. So, that x0 belongs to M is said to be fixed point F of x0 is equal to x0. Means, after applying F also, it is not changing. Okay? After applying f on x0, we are getting its image as x0 only. Therefore, it is called as a fixed point of that map. Is that okay? So, for identity map, what are the fixed points? What are the fixed points for identity map?
X.
What? How many fixed points for the identity map? Suppose this is my F from M to or R to R, you take R to R, defined by F of X is equal to X. My question is, how many fixed points are there? Fixed points of F is no fixed point. No fixed point. I will give you option also, okay? B, two fixed points. C, infinitely many or infinite, and D, finite. So which option is true?
C.
Infinite.
So every point of R is a fixed point here, right? Because f of x is equal to x, f of 1 is equal to 1, f of 2 is equal to 2. So that every point is a fixed point for identity map. Is that okay? This,
yes sir.
Okay. Another example also we can have, F from R to, suppose F from R to R, defined by F of X is equal to X minus half. What are the fixed points for this map? How many fixed points for this map?
No.
Same options. Same options. Same question. Only map I have changed.
No fixed point. No.
No fixed point. Everybody agrees with this? Everybody agrees, no fixed point?
Yes, ma'am. Yes.
Okay. I hope you understood what is fixed point. Okay?
Excuse me, ma'am.
Yes?
Fixed point ka map se par identity map ke liye le sakte hai, to dusra bhi le sakte
hai. Nahi na, dusre ke liye bhi le sakte na.
Matlab, for example,
कौन सा
मतलब जैसे कि नेचुरल नंबर टू रियल नंबर
ऐसे, हाँ, कोई कोई भी, बट इट शुड सेटिस्फाई दिस प्रॉपर्टी एफ ऑफ एक्स जीरो इज इक्वल टू एक्स जीरो. ओके
ठीक है.
ओके सो नाउ नेक्स्ट थ्योरम विच इज अगेन इंपॉर्टेंट थ्योरम, Banach contraction principle. So this name Banach is nothing but a mathematician name, contraction principle. So we are using here contraction map. Okay, so what is this Banach contraction principle says? Let MD be a complete metric space. This is important again. Let MD be a complete metric space and F from M to M be a contraction map. Then F has a unique fixed point. So this theorem is used in infinitely many papers. Not infinitely, I can say, but many, many papers, many research papers or many researchers whose area is fixed point theory, they have used this theorem rigorously. Okay. So this is very useful in application point of view, this theorem, Banach contraction principle or Banach contraction theorem, you can say. Okay, so what is its requirement? Our original, what is underlying space, that should be complete. So one requirement is the underlying space should be complete matrix space, and the map should be contraction map. Then it must has a unique fixed point. And moreover, for given x0 in M, the sequence of functional iterations, what is this functional iteration? F raised to n x0 is always converges to a fixed point of f. So what is this fn of x0? Fn of x0 is nothing but like f of x0. It is nothing but my f2 of x0. Okay, first we will have f of x0. If I again take its image under f, that is nothing but f2. Now again you apply f on this, you will get f3. Again apply f on this, you will get f4, and so on. Okay, so number of iterates, so nth iterates converges to, means fn of x0, this sequence always converges to a fixed point of f. Is that okay? Statement of the theorem, yes. Understood? So first we will show it has a unique fixed point. If it is underlying space is a complete matrix space and f is a contraction map, then we will show it has a unique fixed point, and then we will show it will converge to that fixed point is nothing but limit point of fn of x0. So okay, first we will show this one. Okay, in this we have already, first we have shown this. So let x0 belongs to M and fn of x0 converges. Now M is complete, so it is enough to show that fn of x0 is Cauchy, right? Since it is complete, every Cauchy sequence converges. Is that okay? So we will show this fn of x0 is a Cauchy sequence. Now f is given to be contraction, so by definition of contraction, what will happen? There exist alpha, there exist alpha which lies between 0 to 1, which lies between 0 to 1, such that distance of fx comma fy is less than equal to alpha times distance of xy. I will write it again. Distance of fx comma fy is less than equal to alpha times distance of xy. This is for every xy belongs to M, because of f is a contraction map. Now you start it taking this, consider n plus 1th iterate. Distance of n plus 1th iterate of f of x0 and fn of x0. How can I write this? This I can, fn plus 1, how I can write this? I can write this as fn of f of x0, right? Mm-hmm. So this is nothing but distance of, and fn I can write as f of fn minus 1. Now fn of x0 and fn minus 1 of x0, these are nothing but points in M only. So, and f is contraction. So what I will get? It can be less than or equal to alpha times distance between this. Is that okay? Because my f is a contraction map. And again, apply the same thing. Now, fn you write f of fn minus 1, and fn minus 1 you write f of fn minus 2. Then again, we will get alpha times distance of this one. So, I will get here alpha square. Is that okay, this?
Yes, ma'am.
And so on, you go on continuing repeating that procedure, you will get alpha raised to n d of f of x0 comma x0 here. Is that okay? Are you getting this?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am.
So, but what is distance of f of x0 and x0? Alpha raised to n times c, some constant. So for n less than m, if I again calculate this distance of fn x0 and fm x0, I want to show it is Cauchy. So consider this now. This can be written as distance of fn x0 plus fn plus 1 of x0. I am applying repetitively triangle inequality. Okay, in this. Are you getting this?
Yes, ma'am.
Fn plus 1 and fn plus 1. Now using triangle inequality, we have written this like this. Distance of xy is always less than or equal to distance of xz plus distance of zy. Is that right? So just instead of xy, this is my x, this is my y, and this is my z. Is that okay?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am.
Now again, you repeatedly apply to this. Now, n plus 1, n plus 2. Okay? And like this. We can write like this. Fm of x0. So, already we have calculated what is distance of fn x0 and fn plus 1 of x0. It is alpha raised to n times c. Is that right? What is next will be alpha raised to n plus 1 times c. What will be next? Alpha raised to m minus 1 times c. So this I can write as c times summation k is equal to n to m minus 1 alpha raised to k. What is this series? This series is nothing but alpha raised to n 1 minus alpha raised to m minus n divided by 1 minus alpha. And therefore distance of fn x0 comma fm x0 is less than equal to c upon 1 minus alpha raised to n 1 minus alpha raised to m minus n. Now as n tends to infinity, alpha raised to n tends to 0. Why? As n tends to infinity, alpha raised to n tends to 0. Why? What we know about x raised to n? It tends to 0, infinity, when? As n tends to infinity. When it will tends to 0 and when it will tends to infinity? If mod x is less than 1, then it tends to 0. If mod x is strictly greater than 1, it tends to infinity. Do you know this?
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah, and if x is equal to 1, where it tends to? There will be three cases. As n tends to infinity, I will write here. When this mod x is strictly less than 1, mod x is greater, strictly greater than 1 and equal to 1 if mod x is equal to 1. Is it right?
Yes, ma'am.
So here how is my alpha? What is my alpha? Here alpha belongs to close 0, open 1. Because f is a contraction map. Since f is a contraction map, alpha is strictly less than 1. Therefore, alpha raised to n tends to 0. You can write here, since alpha belongs to close 0, open 1. or you can say since F is a contraction map, therefore what can I say? Distance of fnx 0, fmx 0 tends to 0 as n tends to infinity, and therefore fnx 0 is a Cauchy sequence. Now, since it is a Cauchy sequence, and f is a contraction, f must be a continuous map. Every contraction map is a continuous map. You can take this as exercise. You can easily prove, or you can take as every contraction map is a continuous map, or contraction map is a continuous map. Every, no need to say, just contraction map is a, or contraction implies continuous. What about reverse? Okay. Contraction implies continuous, but continuous need not be contraction. This you take as a homework. Now, since f is a contraction, f is continuous, what is f of limit of fn of x0? It will be f of x, because this we are considering as x. Therefore, limit n tends to infinity, fn plus 1 of x0 is nothing but f of x. Therefore, f of x is nothing but x. Therefore, x is a fixed point of f. Now, we have to prove it has a unique fixed point. So, start with two fixed points. So let x and y be two fixed points of f. Two fixed points of f means fx is equal to x and fy is equal to y. So what is distance between xy? I can write distance between xy as fx comma fy, but f is a contraction map, so it will be less than or equal to alpha times distance of xy. So this I can write as 1 minus alpha times distance of xy, which is less than or equal to 0. Therefore, distance of xy must, alpha is not equal to 1, right? This is non-zero, means distance of xy must be 0, less than or equal to 0, or, but distance cannot be less than, negative, right? So it must be equal to 0. You can see, since 1 is, alpha is not equal to 1. Reverse side, right? Alpha is not equal to 1. Therefore, x must be equal to y. Therefore, it has a unique fixed point. Is that okay?
Yes, sir.
Yes, ma'am.
So, if space is a complete metric space and we have a contraction map, then that F must have a unique fixed point. And moreover, it converges to its iterates, and that sequence of iterates, nth iterates sequence, you can say. Now, this is lemma, you can say. Next one. Let MD be a complete metric space and F is a continuous. Here not given contraction, but here it is given to be, sorry. Now, so let MD be a complete metric space. F is continuous, and what is given? F raised to K is a contraction for some K belongs to N. Then also F has a unique fixed point. Okay. So, in above theorem, what is given? We don't know whether that f is continuous or not, but what is given there? F is contraction. F is contraction means it must be continuous. But in this theorem, f raised to k, kth iterate is contraction. We don't know about f, whether f is contraction or not. Okay. But if its kth iterate is also contraction, and f is continuous, then also we can say that it has a unique fixed point. So we will start proving this. Suppose Fk is a contraction. So by Banach contraction, Fk has a fixed point, because my underlying space is complete and Fk is contraction. Therefore, this kth iterate of F has a unique fixed point by Banach contraction theorem. So F raised to k of x0 is nothing but x0. Now we want to show this F of x0 is also fixed point of F. First we will show F of x0 is a fixed point of F raised to k, and then we show that F of x0 is x0. Okay. Now what is F raised to k of F of x0? It is F of F raised to k of x0. Can I write like this? F raised to k of F of x0 is nothing but F of F raised to k of x0. But what is my F raised to k at x0? It is x0. Therefore, F of x0 is a fixed point of F raised to k. Means F of x0 is a fixed point of F raised to k, and F raised to k has a unique fixed point. Therefore, F of x0 must be x0. Is that okay?
Yes, ma'am.
So I think for today this much is enough.
Hello, ma'am.
Yes.
Can you explain the last step?
The last step. This x0?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. What is given here? F raised to k is a contraction, ma'am. Okay, so it must have a unique fixed point. So assume x0 is fixed point of F raised to k. Means what? F raised to k of x0 is nothing but x0. Okay, so by Banach contraction we are having this. Now what is our aim? I want to show F of x0 is also fixed point of F raised to k. So if I want to show that, start with F raised to k of F of x0. This I can write as F of F raised to k of x0. Can I write like this?
Yes, ma'am.
You can write, consider this. Now, but what is F raised to k of x0? It is x0 only. So what can I say from this step? F of x0 is a fixed point of which map? F raised to k. Now x0 is a fixed point. F of x0 is a fixed point. And we know that it has a unique fixed point. Therefore, what we must have? F of x0 must be same as x0. Are you getting this?
Yes, ma'am.
Therefore, x0 is a fixed point of F. Means using kth iterate of F, we are getting fixed point of F. Is that okay?
Yes, ma'am.
By Banach contraction principle. This is lemma of Banach contraction theorem. Okay, so any doubts?